you know, we have a panel of representative group of fellows who have instructed exactly what they should say. And therefore, we'll be very careful about what they say to an unsuspecting audience. But first of all, Sylvia, of course, is here. You saw her during the reception. Helen Hirschkopf, of course, was supposed to be here. My mother died in the last couple of days, and she, therefore, can't join us, although she may be here a little later. I'm just not sure. And here's Adam Cox, a relatively new professor at NYU Law School, who has now joined the ACE program. We have worked with Adam for a few years. We know him well, and we think it's a wonderful opportunity for all of you to get to know him well. So he will be the moderator, and I will say not another word. And here is David, and we can start. Okay.
Thank you, Norman. So my impression when I came to NYU was that the Hayes program was centrally concerned with free speech, but now I discover that apparently Norman has given strict directions to the panelists about what we're going to be speaking about today. In my couple of years with the program, the one thing that I've recognized really quickly is that nobody stands on ceremony. So I think the way we'll run this panel is that, let me just tell you who's here, and then we're going to go in reverse seniority order. And each person will introduce themselves a bit and then talk about the question that everyone was posed before the panel. After they've each had a chance to make opening remarks, to the extent that their opening remarks raise questions as among them, I might sort of invite a few of those questions, and then I'll encourage everybody else to join the conversation. So we have, working from left to right, David Rudovsky, Rachel Meeropol, Rachel Goodman, Maddy deLone, Gemma Solimene, and also Eric Lieberman. So why don't we start? Let's see, the most junior person I think is Rachel.
It's true. Being junior, I don't have a lot of experience with the microphone. But so as the most junior person on the panel, I should warn you up front that I'm going to take a little bit of liberty with the question, which I found very difficult. So I may dodge it a little bit. So I graduated from NYU and the Hayes program in 2010. And I am a staff attorney at the ACLU Racial Justice Program in New York, where I work on a range of issues, including economic justice and racial profiling issues. So the prompt here is, which case did the civil libertarians lose in the Supreme Court in recent years that we can best live with, or even may have been right? And I know what Norman was getting at with this prompt. I'm supposed to say something deeply iconoclastic about, you know, the true sort of conservative streak in me that I don't often share, but I can share in this group. I'm not exactly going to do that. Because frankly, I had a really hard time thinking about a recent decision that the civil libertarians lost. And there have been some that the civil libertarians have won, right? There's some Fourth Amendment stuff that I can live with. But I don't think that's what the question was getting at. So in thinking about the question, I thought a lot about what it means to, what does it mean that we can best live with it, right? And part of that question to me pointed at this dichotomy that comes up when you're thinking about Supreme Court jurisprudence. There's a certain category of decisions, constitutional decisions, where the Supreme Court really has the final say, and there's not much we can do when we see the Supreme Court is headed, you know, in the wrong direction or has come out with a decision that is completely antithetical to what we believe the Constitution says. And then there's this other category of decisions that I don't want to call sort of simply statutory decisions, because these can be, I think, often, I want to say that this category also includes decisions in which the Supreme Court assesses the constitutionality of a statute, right? Like in recently in Shelby County versus Holder, where the Supreme Court's decision isn't sort of the be-all and end-all. There's a chance for the political process to react to the decision of the Supreme Court, and maybe that's part of what it means to live with a decision later on. So as an example, I wanted to start off by talking about a decision that maybe also violates the rule of the panel by not being so immediately recent. I wanted to talk about Leadbetter versus Goodyear Tire and Rubber, right? And that's an example of a decision in which the Supreme Court very clearly called for some legislative response, and the legislative response happened. And so down the road, as civil libertarians, we can live with the outcome of Leadbetter because what's happened is right. So just by way of background there, as folks probably remember, Lilly Ledbetter brought a Title VII sex discrimination claim, and the issue before the Supreme Court was a statute of limitations question, it was an intentional discrimination claim based on pay disparities. And the majority in the Supreme Court said that because the intentional discrimination she was alleging happened before the statute of limitations period, the effect of that discrimination, meaning the paychecks that she was receiving that contained discriminatory wages, were not enough to carry the intent forward into the statute of limitations period. And so her claims were time barred. And then, of course, in the dissent, Justice Ginsburg really forcefully disagreed with the majority's interpretation of this earlier case, Bazemore versus Friday, which was a case about the integration of the North Carolina Agriculture Extension Service. I've never known what an extension service is, but it comes up in this jurisprudence. And that was a case in which the service had been explicitly segregated and then integrated after Title VII, but pay disparities remained between African-American and white employees. And the Supreme Court had there held that even though the disparity in pay was due in part to discrimination that had occurred in the past, it was, you know, that the claims still fell within the statute of limitations period. So in Ledbetter, the majority says that Bazemore was a case about a continuing policy of pay discrimination because it hadn't been ameliorated from the sort of the officially segregatory part of the system. And Ginsburg said that was the wrong interpretation, that it was in fact exactly like the Ledbetter situation where present disparities are resulting from the discriminatory system in the past. And then, you know, most importantly for our purposes here, Justice Ginsburg's dissent closes with this very explicit call to Congress, right? She says, once again, the ball is in Congress's court, as in 1991, calling back to the amendments to the Civil Rights Act then, the legislature may act to correct the court's parsimonious reading of Title VII. And so then we have the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act in 2009, which very explicitly repudiates, I mean, not only with its title, but in various places in the statute, including in addition to, you know, making explicit in the statute that this kind of paycheck discrimination in an intent case does qualify within the statute of limitations. I like this move in the Fair Pay Act, which says explicitly that it is to take effect as if enacted on May 28th, 2007, which is the day before the Supreme Court decision in Ledbetter, right? So nobody was beating around the bush about what happened in the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act of 2009. So that was a different time, a little bit, in political history. It was the very beginning of Barack Obama's presidency. The Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act was brought to the floor as kind of this ceremonial first act of the 111th Congress. And it was a pretty good time for getting things done that civil libertarians are pleased about. We're at a different time now, and I know Gemma is gonna talk a bit more about Shelby, but you know, that's sort of the second half of what I'm thinking about here. Shelby County versus Holder, which is struck down on constitutional grounds, Section 4, the coverage formula of Section 4 of the Voting Rights Act, it could turn out okay, right? Like Ledbetter, even though Shelby is a decision on constitutional grounds rather than statutory interpretation grounds, Congress still has the opportunity to respond here, and maybe Shelby will turn out to be a decision we can live with. I think there are a couple reasons that it's not exactly the same situation. One, as we all know, the Voting Rights Act reauthorization in 2006 contained 15,000 pages of legislative record in support of the provision that was struck down. So I don't think we have a guarantee that if Congress rejiggers the formula, we might not find ourselves at this same kind of constitutional wall again in the future. The other difference, obviously, is that although Congress has not been a perfectly functioning institution for some time, and I don't want to suggest that it was in 2007 or in 2009, I don't think things were at quite the impasse that we have come to now. Right? We have a Congress that can't pass a budget, which is pretty much the most basic function of a legislature, and I guess I have a lot of, even though my colleagues at the ACLU Washington Legislative Office are working really hard on it, and I, you know, there is reason, I think, to think something might happen with the Voting Rights Act. I worry a lot about how this gets through a Congress this dysfunctional. And then finally, I think the Voting Rights Act is different because it's about the political system itself, right? If in the absence of Section 4, we end up with a Congress that's even less reflective of America and more disproportionately representative of this white, male, rural minority set of interests, then Congress has even kind of reduced incentive and chance of fixing the problem, which compounds itself further. So I haven't really answered the question. I've maybe set up a depressing idea about my dodge of the question, but I'll leave it there for now.
Thank you, Rachel. Rachel?
Hi, everybody. So my name is Rachel Meeropol, Rachel Part 2 here. I graduated from NYU in 2002, and I've been at the Center for Constitutional Rights ever since, where my practice focuses on prisoners' rights and First Amendment law. I also found this a little bit of a challenging question, but one thing I've learned as a practitioner is that when given a question that isn't necessarily the question you want to be asked, you bridge to message. You'll see where I'm going with this. So the First Amendment, I think, frequently presents odd alliances on the court. I'm going to talk about Osborne v. Ohio, which if you thought that Ledbetter was taking recent a little widely, then I guess I'm certainly guilty of that as well. But it's a recent case, just like I am a young attorney. Osborne v. Ohio is a 1990 Supreme Court case, which presented a 6-3 split. Justice White delivered the opinion of the court, joined by Rehnquist, Blackmun, O'Connor, Scalia, and Kennedy, with Brennan, Marshall, and Stevens in dissent. At issue was Ohio's child pornography law, which outlawed possession or viewing of any material or performance that shows a minor who is not the person's child or ward in a state of nudity, unless the material has a bona fide artistic, medical, scientific, educational, religious, governmental, judicial, or other proper purpose, or there's written parental consent. Now, Clyde Osborne was convicted of violating the statute and challenged it as unconstitutionally overbroad on its face, despite the fact that he certainly did not have a First Amendment challenge to his own conduct. The state Supreme Court affirmed his conviction over his First Amendment defense and found the statute constitutional. Key to the decision was the Ohio Supreme Court's interpretation of state of nudity to be limited to depictions of nudity involving a lewd exhibition or graphic focus on the genitals. The Supreme Court granted cert. Now, Osborne urged the Supreme Court to strike down the statute on overbreath grounds. The overbreath doctrine, as I'm sure most of you know, allows a criminal defendant or a civil litigant who's bringing a facial pre-enforcement challenge to challenge a law as impermissibly overbroad, as infringing on First Amendment protected activity, even when the defendant's own conduct is not protected by the First Amendment. Though there's been significant doctrinal uncertainty about the appropriate quantum used to measure overbreath, it's clear that, you know, some infringement of speech at the margins of a law's applicability is not going to allow for overbreath success. But when a statute is unconstitutional, when a statute is unconstitutional on its face, there's the First Amendment impact is real and substantial, judged in relation to the statute's legitimate sweep. So here, for example, you know, under the plain language of the Ohio statute, it would really criminalize possessing nude any nude photograph of a child who is not your own child. So as the mom of two young kids, I can personally attest to the very real constitutional injury I would feel if I were prohibited from sharing bathtub photographs of my children with their grandparents and their aunts. This should probably be equally disturbing to all of you in the audience who have received similar photographs of your distant family members or close family members without realizing that you were in possession of child pornography. Now, to be fair, this interpretation isn't exactly cut and dry. The statute made an exception for photographs that were disseminated for any proper purpose, and arguably photo sharing with your relatives is a proper purpose. But, you know, actually as a matter of statutory interpretation, it's a pretty close question, because all the other proper uses described in the statute are of a very different nature. Thus, if the statute were to be interpreted under its plain meaning, there was at least the possibility of a very real overbreath problem. So the majority in the Supreme Court avoided this problem by relying on the Ohio court's narrow interpretation of the statute to only apply to nude and lewd photographs, even though lewd or nothing like it does not appear in the statute. Now, as the court explained, once the statute was authoritatively construed, there is no longer any danger that protected speech, including adorable baby photographs, would be deterred. The dissent disagreed, arguing that even as construed, the statute was vague and broad enough to deter protected speech, not just child pornography. I'm not going to go so far as to say that I agree with the majority here, and I don't think that the majority holding was correct. Rather, I think the case is interesting because it provides an example of how those of us who would challenge the breadth of a statute's reach, particularly in the First Amendment context, can succeed in limiting the reach of that statute by prompting the courts to interpret it narrowly, even as they lose their constitutional challenge. So any individual out there who followed the Osborne case out of, you know, real concern that her nude but not lewd child photos would be prescribable comes out of the case having lost the battle but won the war. The statute cannot be applied to her conduct. So I'm a civil rights litigator. I do value the First Amendment, but I didn't choose to discuss this case simply because I have an enduring interest in protecting bathtub shots. Rather, I think the concept here is interesting, and it's one that I see that I've found some interest in some of my own work. Now, some of you might have heard of the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act. It's a federal criminal statute that prohibits traveling in interstate commerce and damaging or causing the loss of any real or personal property belonging to an animal enterprise. The statute defines animal enterprise incredibly broadly. It's any business or nonprofit that uses or sells animal products. So this is everything from Whole Foods to NYU to the Big Apple Circus or an animal testing lab. The law does not define causing damage or loss to real or personal property, but read logically, in keeping with Black's Law Dictionary, this would include causing loss of intangible property, like money, because money, of course, is a form of property. In other words, the statute prescribes causing a business to lose profits. This seems unconstitutional. So last year, the Center for Constitutional Rights filed Blum v. Holder, which is a pre-enforcement facial challenge to the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act. Plaintiffs are five animal rights activists who've been chilled from continuing their First Amendment-protected advocacy on behalf of animal rights, like showing a documentary about foie gras production out of fear that their efforts will, as is their intent, affect the bottom line of animal exploitation industries, thus turning them into terrorists. The case was dismissed on standing in the district court, based on the judge's narrow, and I would argue unsupportable, reading of damaging or causing the loss of any real or personal property to include only damage to tangible property. We're appealing the cases before the First Circuit, but this is where the doctrinally interesting part comes in, I think. You know, if every circuit in the country interpreted the statute in the same narrow way, it would still be far from perfect. For example, it allows someone who releases mink from a fur farm to be prosecuted as a terrorist. However, its chill on lawful First Amendment protected activity would certainly decrease. So In other words, you know, while a win in a case like this is certainly a win, you get the statute struck down, a loss can also be a win, as the statute is narrowed. And for those of us litigating civil rights cases under this Supreme Court, this kind of winning by losing may really be the best we can hope for. That's all I've got.
Okay. I guess I wonder if there's anybody on the panel that liked the question we were asked when we got asked it. I will say we all agreed to speak before hearing the question. And therefore, we're answering it as we choose.
I never challenge Warren Norman's decisions.
There you go. We're not challenging it either. We're abiding by them. I don't practice law any longer, and I'm not at the Civil Liberties Union. I graduated from NYU in 2004 and was a prisoners' rights litigator at the Prisoners' Rights Project at Legal Aid for almost a decade when I left to become the executive director at the Innocence Project, which represents prisoners across the country who have claims of innocence that can be proven with DNA. So when I got the question, the very good question, which case did the civil libertarians lose in the Supreme Court in recent years that we can live with or may even have been right, I decided that the only fair thing for me to do was to think about the Supreme Court's decisions in recent years that affected the clients and that I could speak to just given the work that I do. And while there are several in the area of criminal procedure that are decided right or certainly that we can live with, the two that were most directly implicated the two that our work was most directly implicated by was a decision in Osborne versus Alaska, which is a case about the right to post-conviction DNA testing, but I wasn't sure you'd all be that interested in the decision. And the issue of Thompson v. Connick, which was a decision about whether or not the Orleans parish could be held liable under a failure to train theory for the wrongful conviction and near execution of John Thompson in Louisiana. And while we lost that case, and by losing, just as the Supreme Court decided in a Justice Thomas decision that a single Brady violation could not be recognized as failure to train and incurring liability on the municipality, I think that, and maybe it's winning the war, I think that it actually had profound implications in both the arguments that were made, Justice Ginsburg's very, you know, sort of smart, detailed, careful, thoughtful, and, you know, an angry dissent about what in fact had gone on in Orleans Parish, not a single Brady claim at all. But that, and the aftermath of that decision, which really outraged people because John Thompson, and I'll tell you a little bit about him, did come within several weeks of execution based on intentional decision by the prosecutor's office, at least one person and maybe as many as four or five, to not turn over evidence in his case. John Thompson was 22 years old in 1985. When he was charged with murder in a Orleans Parish murder. While he was waiting for trial, someone in a second unrelated case, an armed robbery, he was implicated in the armed robbery conviction, and it's in that case that the prosecutors had blood evidence of the perpetrator on the clothes of one of the victims in the armed robbery, that they got tested, and that they never bothered to find out whether it was John Thompson's blood or not, but they never disclosed the fact of that testing and the fact of that blood to the defense attorneys. Fast forward, John Thompson gets convicted, sentenced to 49 years for armed robbery. There are a lot of other problems and a lot of Brady violations in that armed robbery case, but he's convicted and sentenced to 49 years in prison. Facing 49 years in prison, his defense attorney on the murder conviction suggests that he not take the stand in his own defense in the murder conviction. The prosecution, and we won't talk about all the Brady violations in the murder conviction, but there were numerous that came out over time. The prosecution says in its penalty phase that given that he's already serving 49 years for this armed robbery, that death is the only real appropriate response in the capital case, and John Thompson is sentenced to death. It is about 3.5 weeks before he is to be executed that an investigator finds the lab reports and the clothing, the fact that this, that in fact in this armed robbery, the state held possession of evidence which proved that John Thompson was in fact not the person who committed the armed robbery, and that they knew it, and that the same people involved in that case knew it when they took John Thompson to trial for the murder conviction. So the Supreme Court asked that the John Thompson was exonerated of both the armed robbery and eventually on acquitted at retrial in about in a 35-minute jury deliberation on the murder conviction. And 18 years later, after serving 14 years on death row, walked out of the New Orleans Orleans Parish and was in theory a free man. John sued the several people in the Orleans Parish DA's office and the office itself, and in a district court hearing in Louisiana, prevailed and was awarded $18 million by a jury. The decision was affirmed by the Fifth Circuit, not known to be, you know, a wildly progressive circuit, but found for John Thompson, and the case went up to the Supreme Court. By the time it got to the Supreme Court, the question really was this very narrow question. Could the municipality be held liable for failure to train on a single Brady violation? And Justice Thomas, as I said earlier, and as you may know, said no. Was it right? Can we live with it? In some ways, as it is, and maybe this is David will answer later, can we really live with it, but or someone else on the panel who continues to litigate these claims, but in some way, as construed and described by Thomas, the question was so narrow, and his recitation of the facts, while completely contrived, describes this single act of Brady, and I think maybe if that's really the standard that we hold ourselves to on failure to train claims, we can live with it, because it would certainly be possible and likely, and often is the case, that you have a much more profound record than the record as recited by Justice Thomas. So maybe we can live with it. But I think I'm going to sort of take what Rachel was saying and the way I thought about this case, Rachel 1, and to some extent Rachel 2, and say that it has made an enormous difference in a broader context about prosecutorial accountability and the right of defendants in the context of Brady. And that it was both in the filing of the briefs and the amicus brief by the National District Attorneys Association and others that sort of an outrageous statements were made about how accountable, about the accountability systems that hold prosecutors in this country to being honest. And one of the things that we did at the Innocence Project and with our friends in the network around the country is to get together 19 exonerated people. Many of them had served time on death row. All of them who had had Brady claims in their cases, most of them dismissed when there were challenges and people told them there was harmless error in those cases. But in none of those cases was any prosecutor actually held accountable by any means that anybody could identify. And since the decision, we have gone around the country, as have others, and looked at the accountability systems for prosecutors, the kinds of things that the Supreme Court talked about, the fact that they said, well, there's office training that goes on, even if it's not required and constitutionally mandated, and that doesn't, in fact, seem to be the case. There are bar disciplinary committees, and the Yale Law Journal did a great review of all the disciplinary systems in the country and found that they are almost all inadequate to the task of holding prosecutors accountable, and if even if they were adequate to the task, they almost never do it. That we have criminal law, you know, you have the possibility of criminal prosecution when there are, you know, violations of people's constitutional rights under Brady. And in fact, you can find almost no decisions since Brady where someone was held criminally or prosecutors held criminally liable for failure to disclose evidence. And I think we are now beginning to see legislatures around the country that are looking at prosecutorial oversight and holding people accountable for Brady, passing laws in Texas about accountability of prosecutors, having forums around the country, raising the issue and trying to figure out what in fact can we do about misconduct by prosecutors. And none of this was happening, at least in my 10 years of experience in this area, at the same level and with the same persistence prior to the decision in Connick. So can we live with the decision as civil libertarians? Perhaps, perhaps not. Did it have some things happen that were better for having the decision? I think absolutely. Perhaps if John had gotten the $18 million that he was granted by the Fifth Circuit or by the district court, we would have thought that something reasonable had happened and we might have gone away and been quiet. But when they said no to John Thompson, people said enough is enough. And if there's anybody in the country that did not do okay and for whom this was not a good decision, it is John Thompson, who works carefully every single day and across the country to try to make sure that prosecutors are held accountable for the things that he did. And so it is sort of for him that I have to say it was okay because that's what he said. If this makes them change, then it's okay if it happened to me. So that's my thought on, is it okay?
Gemma.
Hi, it's nice to see everyone. My name is Gemma Solimene. I was a 1986-87 Hayes Fellow, and I have to say, although my fellow panelists David and Eric won't appreciate this statement, whenever I say I graduated from law school in 87, I feel like the years are are just upon me here, and I'm dating myself. I know I just said David and Eric won't appreciate this, but I feel like I'm dating myself. In any event, I am currently a clinical professor at Fordham University School of Law, and my primary area of expertise is immigration. But I did not choose an immigration case as I thought of this. I will admit, I didn't know that I was going to admit this, but as I hear people talking about the struggles that they had with trying to find a case that would answer this question, I initially thought, oh, Bakke, you know, there were a couple of good things that came out of Bakke. You know, the rise of the relevance of diversity permeating all aspects of life and not just education. And then I read the prompt again recently, and it said recent Supreme Court decision. And I thought 1978, probably not gonna fit the bill. So as I searched I thought, all right, let me see what I could do with Shelby. And I chose Shelby, the June 25th, 2013 decision that struck down, as Rachel noted, a key provision of the 1965 Voting Rights Act. And while many of you understandably, the little bit you got from Rachel and what you may know yourselves of that decision might be cocking your head to the side, wondering what I could possibly be thinking, I do want to start by saying that I agree with the civil libertarians, civil rights advocates, and many liberals who have denounced the decision as a bad one. it was just a bad decision. And I agree with the dissent written by Justice Ginsburg and others who have spoken and written about the decision that the majority's opinion is flawed for so many reasons. But keeping the topic in mind, something good may come out of it. And I may be wrong. I hope I'm not, but I may be wrong. So I put that out on the table. It may be, in fact, a decision whose negative effects live on for too many years, but the reason why we may be in a position to say that we can live with it is that the need for a fix to reverse the effects of the decision could be nationwide in scope. Let me step back some, talk a little bit about the provisions of the Voting Rights Act in question in Shelby and about the decision to put this hope that I'm putting forward for a fix in context. The Voting Rights Act was, as you all know, was enacted to address racial discrimination in voting. There are provisions of the act that are sweeping and apply nationwide, like Section 2, that bans any standard practice or procedure that, quote, results in a denial or abridgment of a right of any citizen to vote on account of race or color. That was not the issue in Shelby. What was at issue were sections 4B and 5. And those apply to specific states and counties. So section 4B identified the states and localities that had a longstanding and ongoing nature of racial discrimination in voting by a formula. And section 5 required those places to demonstrate to the federal government, either through the Department of Justice or a federal court or a three-judge panel federal court, that any proposed changes to their voting laws wouldn't be harmful to voters of color, before they can implement them. The states covered had to essentially seek preclearance before any changes can go into effect. And Section 4B essentially was the coverage formula that determined which jurisdictions were subject to Section 5's preclearance requirements. It was initially set to be in place for 5 years from enactment. They continued to be in effect after a number of reauthorizations by Congress, specifically 1970, 1975, 1982, and 2006. These reauthorizations extended coverage. They redefined the definition of what kinds of things would be the tests and devices that would fall under the act. And as Rachel noted earlier, the 2006 congressional reauthorization that was to be in place for 25 years came after nearly a year full of hearings that amassed a 15,000-page record. Congress, in that reauthorization, found, among other things, that the Voting Rights Act had directly caused significant progress in eliminating what was called first-generation barriers that were construed to prevent minority voters from fully participating in the electoral process, had continued to exist. Congress in the 2006 reauthorization found that it had directly caused significant progress in eliminating first-generation barriers to ballot access, but that despite this process, second-generation barriers were construed to prevent minority voters from fully participating in the electoral process continued to exist. These reauthorizations, though, still amounted to sections 4B and 5, being in effect for only certain states and localities. Shelby was a case brought by one of those counties in a state in Alabama, which was a covered jurisdiction, seeking a declaratory judgment that sections 4B and 5 of the Voting Rights Act were facially unconstitutional. They sought a permanent injunction against their enforcement. And as we know, the court struck down the coverage formula set out in section 4B, on the ground that the formula was outdated, and as such, was an impermissible standard to base the justification for the preclearance requirement. So in effect, Section 5, the preclearance section, was rendered inoperative. We have since seen states and localities, those that were formerly covered, such as Texas and North Carolina, and those that hadn't, enact laws that have a racially discriminatory effect. Voter ID laws are a big example of that, redistricting, and the like. And as the Supreme Court itself acknowledged in Shelby, no one doubts the fact that voting discrimination still exists today. So again, the hope then is for something that's not written yet. And trying not to be too discouraged by the current state of our Congress, I will hope that one day this will be written. And that is that the fix and the reason we might be able to live with Shelby is that the court essentially said we need a new formula based on current conditions. well, maybe that new formula based on current conditions will bring in northern states that were not covered because they had no history of discrimination, such as Pennsylvania, Ohio, Wisconsin, that are currently on a rampant move towards all kinds of changes in their voting, that, you know, voter ID, changes in language access hours, changing Sunday voting, early voting laws, that all have been shown to have a discriminatory effect. And so, since we need a new formula based on current conditions, and current conditions go beyond the geographic and historical limitations, I hope, and those that are voting rights experts, which I am not, those that I speak to who have been doing this work for quite a long time, are hoping that the fix will be one that is unencumbered by these geographic and historical context, to addressing voting changes that are demonstrated to be racially discriminatory and or have a racial impact. So I've picked a very, very recent case, and who knows, right? The jury's kind of still out. If I and those who are working on these issues are right that this could be a fix and should be a fix, then yeah, we can live with it. Still won't be a right decision, right? But we can live with it. And if we're wrong on that end, well, it's not only a wrong decision, but we also won't be able to live with it. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Eric Lieberman. I was a graduate fellow 1971 to 72. In fact, Bill Birtles and I were the last two graduate fellows. At the end of our tenure, Norman decided that it just wasn't worth it having graduate fellows. Since then, I've worked at one place for over 40 years, Rabinowitz, Boudin, Standard, Krinsky, and Lieberman, doing a variety of interesting and sometimes not so interesting things, but usually pretty interesting. In District of Columbia versus Heller in 2008, the Supreme Court held that the Second Amendment establishes a personal right of a, quote, responsible person to obtain and own a weapon for, quote, traditionally lawful purposes, including for use in personal defense in the home. I first want to point out some historical context here. The position that the Second Amendment protects individual rights to possess arms for self-defense has hardly been the monopoly of the political right. It was advocated for many years by Southern blacks who often organized armed self-defense groups to protect themselves against the depredations, not only of vigilante groups such as the KKK, but also of state-organized groups. It was advocated by labor groups who armed themselves against the murderous tactics of strikebreakers and Pinkertons. It was advocated by Malcolm X and the Nation of Islam and by the Black Panthers. Indeed, the right to bear arms was an important element in Angela Davis's defense of her murder trial. The right to bear arms was also adopted by various elements of the New Left, including, of course, the Weather Underground, with disastrous results about which we know. Now, I do not mean to say that the use of such tactics or positions by the left was wise or unwise or effective or moral, although I do believe that the armed self-defense of some Southern black groups succeeded in defending their lives, liberty, and property. Rather, I wish to point out how broad the assertion of such a right has been in American political history, and how difficult it therefore has been and will be to achieve anything like broad disarmament. In the words of former SNCC leader H.Rap Brown, violence is as American as apple pie. Turning to Heller itself, the remarkable thing about the decision is how narrow it is, or at least how narrow it potentially it is, subject, of course, to further decisions by the Supreme Court. The statute in question undoubtedly was one of the strictest gun control measures ever enacted in this country. That is exactly why it was singled out for challenge as a test case. The statute barred all possession of handguns by anybody in the District of Columbia, except it grandfathered in those who had owned and registered guns before 1975. With respect to other weapons, it required that they be kept unloaded and disassembled or bound by a trigger lock. The court held that these restrictions overly burdened what it deemed the core purpose of the Second Amendment, which was to permit self-defense in the home. The court emphasized, however, that the Second Amendment did not support a right to carry any weapon for whatever purpose and of whatever nature, emphasizing that the carrying of concealed weapons in public places has long been prohibited. In particular, the court except in Texas. In particular, the court recognized several long-standing prohibitions on the right to own or carry a weapon, and stated that these prohibitions, or suggested at least that these prohibitions, do not even trigger Second Amendment review. These restrictions include restrictions on felons, on the mentally ill, restrictions on the carrying of weapons in, quote, sensitive places such as schools or government locations, and restrictions or qualifications on commercial sales, although the court did not elaborate what it meant by that. Beyond these long-standing prohibitions, the court identified three primary factors that must be considered in judging whether other types of regulations are permissible. First, it said, the Second Amendment only covers firearms, quote, in common use at the time. Now, one would have hoped that as an originalist, Justice Scalia's use of the term at the time meant 1791, but it didn't. He meant now. Second, more important probably, the amendment does not protect the possession of the use of, quote, dangerous or unusual weapons, which it noted has historically been banned. And the court suggested that one such dangerous and unusual weapon would be the M16 machine gun used by the military. In an interview, reassuringly, Justice Scalia gave another example and stated that another such weapon would be a head axe used to decapitate a condemned prisoner, thereby reestablishing his credentials as an originalist. Third, the Second Amendment protection would turn on the degree that there exists a nexus between the weapons at issue and the core self-defense needs. Now, Justice Breyer challenged this limitation as meaningless in his dissent, to which the court, through Justice Scalia, countered that the self-defense nexus was, quote, the central component of the Second Amendment right. Now, when these prohibitions and factors are applied to some of the key efforts to impose reasonable gun control limitations that are under consideration today, I submit that they do not prohibit any of them. And the lower courts have tended to agree. For example, one of the main areas of contention is magazine size. Here we're talking about the large or super large ammunition magazines that were used in the massacres in Arizona, Colorado, Connecticut, and God knows where else. While the use of such large magazines unfortunately may now be, quote, in common use, precisely because of the marketing efforts of the masters of death, otherwise known as gun manufacturers, their use woefully fails to meet the criteria of non-dangerous or non-unusual weapons. These weapons are literally weapons of mass destruction in a domestic context. They are also not necessary to meet the core self-defense needs of the ordinary person in his home. Applying these criteria, the District of Columbia Circuit, the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit, in a subsequent decision also involving Heller, D.C. amended its statute after the decision. It was then challenged again by Heller, and the amended statute included limitations on magazine size, ban on assault weapons, and registration requirements. And the Court of Appeals upheld those restrictions on the basis of the Supreme Court's analysis in Heller 1. Second, assault weapons. Once again, the same analysis applies to assault weapons, except in addition to being unusually dangerous and not necessary to ordinary self-defense needs, they do not appear to meet even the criteria of being in common use, although time may change that. As I said, the Heller Court upheld the restrictions on those as well. Finally, registration and background checks. Well, the court emphasized that among the traditional limitations that it suggests are beyond even Second Amendment review are limitations on gun ownership of certain types of people, such as felons, mentally ill, the children, etc. It would appear inexorably true that a government that has a power to institute such prohibitions has a right to enforce them through registration and background check requirements. Since the Heller decision in 2008, I think I did some research. There are, I guess, about over 80 cases that have been heard in the lower federal courts alone on the constitutionality of a wide variety of gun control laws. These involve bans of firearm possessions by felons, drug addicts, illegal aliens, individuals convicted of domestic violence misdemeanors, cases involving the constitutionality of laws prohibiting certain types of weapons, such as machine guns, sawed-off shotguns, and various kinds of attachments to weapons, and challenges to laws barring guns in post offices, near schools, outlawing straw purchases, outlawing carrying of concealed weapons, and outlawing types of ammunition and possession of unregistered firearms. The courts have upheld almost all of these laws as unconstitutional. Just to give a few examples, the Second Circuit upheld a prohibition on carrying a concealed weapon in public. The First Circuit upheld a restriction on possession by a person convicted of a misdemeanor, not a felony, for domestic violence. The Fourth Circuit upheld a prohibition upon possession of a handgun in a national park. The Fifth Circuit upheld a federal statute prohibiting licensed firearm dealers from selling handguns to persons under 21. The Third Circuit upheld a criminal conviction for carrying a handgun with an obliterated serial number. Numerous state court decisions are to the same effect. But these cases, of course, involve either federal regulations at the margin of the problem or state or municipal attempts to solve a national problem that transcends borders. Ultimately, the chief obstacle to meaningful, national, comprehensive gun control legislation is not the Supreme Court, is not the Heller decision, at least not yet. The problem, I submit, is ourselves, is our social history, is our political culture, and most of all, is our governmental architecture. While according to a variety of recent and not so recent polls that I reviewed just this morning, a significant majority of Americans support legislative action restricting or prohibiting access to assault weapons and high-capacity magazines and requiring national registration and background checks for gun sales and ownership. It is the restrictive structure of our government process that enables resistance to change and reform to succeed, much as it has throughout our history, and much as the sacred founders of our government intended. The Constitution that we all claim, often in worshipful tones, as the source of our freedom and liberty, in fact, is also the reason for our inability to create a better, healthier, safer, let alone great society. If you want to blame someone, don't blame Scalia, blame Madison.
I'm Dave Rudovsky. I was a Hayes Fellow in 1967, which was a time ago. And just to put it in perspective, in 1967, Sylvia Law was still a second-year law student at NYU. And this question would not have come up. It was the height of the Warren Court. Civil libertarians were winning not all cases, but many. And we were about to launch our legal careers, my fellow Hayes Fellows and others, thinking, the future looks bright. And I remember Norman saying at one point, we were discussing that issue and others, he said, don't be so sure, things will change. And the wisdom certainly proved to be true. And so now we have 45 years since then of bad law in many ways, some good cases, but a lot to choose from in terms of cases which were wrongly decided, and I think we probably agree with all the cases that we decided here, probably all wrongly decided. Second Amendment, maybe yes, maybe no. But can we live with it? And we do, right? The fact that we're all here, we continue to practice, we continue to struggle with these issues. As conservative as this court has become in many ways, somehow we find ways of dealing with it and moving some issues at least forward. And indeed, it was just the next year, so I graduated from NYU in 1967, 1968, the draft card burning case came down, which should have been some good indication of what the future was going to be like. I mean, surely there was a free speech claim there. People were burning their draft cards as a symbolic gesture against the Vietnam War. Many, many people did it. It had all kinds of First Amendment overtones. And the Supreme Court, when the case reached it, not surprisingly, by then, 1968, becoming a little more conservative, the Supreme Court said, no, well, it's really not speech, it's conduct. We're just regulating the act of burning the card as if it was some kind of act of arson, as opposed to prohibiting a free speech. And that kind of stuck with me right at that point. And I said, well, things may change. So the case I want to talk about is not O'Brien, which was the draft card burning case, but a case kind of similar to that, and also the reaction to it. And that's the case of Fair versus Rumsfeld, which of course was the Solomon Amendment case. Many of us are familiar with, those who teach were intimately involved with that case. A case in 2006 where the US Supreme Court, as you recall, unanimously, we didn't even get a dissent in that case, unanimously upheld the Solomon Amendment, which was a congressional law that basically said to law schools primarily, but to universities as a whole, that if you accept any federal funding for any purpose whatsoever as a university, law schools, and it was targeted law schools, could not enforce their own anti-discrimination policies, policies that most law schools had adopted in the late 1980s, 1990s, which almost universally across the country, prohibited employers from coming on campus if those employers engaged in discriminatory practices, for example, not hiring gays or lesbians or whatever the discriminatory practice might be. All law schools had these policies, and they were based on enforcing their own anti-discrimination laws. Congress didn't like that because it meant at the time that JAG, which wanted to come on to law schools to recruit law students to be members of JAG and work in the military, that was the period of don't ask, don't tell. Talk about change, right? And things that have happened just in the last 8 years. But there we were, don't ask, don't tell, clearly discriminatory, and law schools around the country started to prohibit JAG recruiters from coming on campus. Challenged the Solomon Amendment because, and Congress kept upping the ante. At first, law schools would be cut off from funds. When that didn't really work because not too many law schools got too many federal funds, the big hammer was the entire university was considered as part of that package. And if the university accepted any federal funds for research or whatever purpose, then those funds would be cut off. And not surprisingly, most law schools found that they just couldn't, and universities couldn't live with that kind of situation. Hence the litigation brought by a kind of coalition of law professors around the country challenging that statute. And again, on First Amendment grounds, it's certainly plausible arguments. Basically an argument of expressive association that universities and law schools claim that they were entitled to enforce their own anti-discrimination policies as part of their message to the community, and indeed a message to LGBT students who were at the school expressing their support, and arguing as well that in effect the Solomon Amendment was a feature of compelled speech, that the government was in fact telling law schools how to speak, what they could say and what they couldn't do, even though the speech was more in terms of regulation. So certainly plausible and perhaps strong First Amendment claims. And yet there was a distinct feeling among many of us who were involved in that litigation, and there were several lawsuits, and I was actually involved in one at Penn Law School, which took a more narrow approach. We thought we actually were able to thread the needle and were in compliance with the regulations because we allowed JAG to interview off campus. We would give them students' names who were interested and still did it. But of course, Congress then changed the law and said, no, that doesn't work either. It's got to be fully equal. And there it was. In fact, fair one of the Third Circuit. Third Circuit found there was a First Amendment violation. Supreme Court took the case up 2006, as I said, 9-0. Two things happened there. I think the decision's wrong, although for a lot of reasons it turned out not to be a terrible decision down the road. And in fact, in one way at least, which I'll talk about, may have been a good decision in terms of protecting, ironically enough, anti-discrimination laws in other contexts. And I'll give one example of that in a moment. Obviously, what the government argued was this was not like other expressive association cases. The plaintiffs in FAIR relied, ironically enough, on that Dale case, the Boy Scout case, right, in which the Supreme Court said that the Boy Scouts could enforce their own practices and policies by not hiring gay scout leaders, and so there was the support here, but of course there was a difference in the Boy Scouts case in Hurley, which was the St. Patrick's Day march in Boston. Really, you could make the argument that these associations, these groups, the law really inhibited their choice of in terms of membership and their message. I mean, there was certainly a clear argument to be made. A little more difficult with the Solomon Amendment. Yes, the schools couldn't quite directly enforce their anti-discrimination policies, but nobody was telling law students, law professors what to say or what not to say. And in fact, fortunately, the court said, of course, anything they say, they can criticize this law all they want. They can hold protests. They can do whatever they want. They just have to let the recruiters on. And it became, unfortunately, I think to the court's eyes and to the public's eyes, more symbolic than real. That in fact, gay and lesbian students weren't really going to think that if law schools had recruiters on campus, that was the law school decision, right? That was the law school doing it or the university doing it, as opposed to the government forcing them to do it. And so some of the sting, some of the arguments you can make on the First Amendment side, I think unfortunately fell a little bit flat. I think they were right, but I think ultimately the court saw it much more symbolic, perhaps like the draft card burning, and therefore said there was no First Amendment claim. This was simply more like conduct, and if you take federal money, then you have to let federal recruiters on. As I say, the underbelly, though, one of the good results of that in terms of the way Rumsfeld was written, and it was fairly narrowly written again in the ways you talked about, because the court emphasized that schools continue to have academic freedom, they can teach the courses they want, people can say what they want, people could hold protests when the recruiters came on, all of that. Nobody was telling anybody they can't say anything or what they had to say, I think, which was true. The potential downside, if FAIR had come out differently, was that it would certainly have been possible then, depending on how that decision might have been written on the other side, and of course we didn't have a dissent, so we don't even know what that would look like, would be that other people on the other side of the political spectrum could then claim that federal laws for example, Title IX, right, a major statute which now for close to 40 years has worked its will in terms of not quite equal funding, but better equal funding for women athletes in schools. What would happen after Rumsfeld if FAIR came out differently? If a school said, well, we're more traditional in our views of gender roles, and to enforce our own practices and policies, we think Title IX is unconstitutional. We don't think women should be playing these sports. And therefore, from a political perspective, we have that right to association. We have that right to send that message. And therefore, we're not bound by Title IX. Would have come out that way? Probably not. But at least it certainly would have given them argument. Indeed, there was a case argued and decided just this past year, a very interesting case in the New Mexico Supreme Court. Colleague of mine, Tobias Wolf, at Penn Law School, actually argued it, and actually Tobias, who's from the gay and lesbian community, argued back in 2006 that this case should not be brought, that it really had potential downsides, the FAIR versus Rumsfeld. The issue in the New Mexico Supreme Court, it's called the Lane Photography. There was a small photography business in New Mexico, which, because of the beliefs genuinely held beliefs of their owners, small business, would not take photographs at same-sex weddings. That was their policy. Same-sex couple called them. They wanted the photography. Went to their website. They called. They said, and then they said something about we're same-sex. They said, we don't do it. We've got religious principles against that. Good luck. We can refer you to some other photographers, but we just won't do that. New Mexico has a human relations law, kind of a public accommodations law, which gave the plaintiffs in that case, the people who sued, a pretty strong claim against Elaine Photography, saying, you're a business, you're a commercial establishment, you can't discriminate among the potential customers who you have, and under the New Mexico law, sexual orientation was one of the covered areas, race, gender, sexual orientation. And therefore, the plaintiffs in that case challenging under that statute said that the photography studio could not refuse to do it. New Mexico Supreme Court just a couple of months ago unanimously upheld the claim for the plaintiffs and actually relied on Rumsfeld and said, maybe if Rumsfeld came out differently, you'd have an argument, but you have no First Amendment argument here. You have no argument that you can make that you are somehow exempted from this anti-discrimination law because you have genuinely held beliefs, right? And your message, the message you don't want to send is endorsing same-sex weddings. You think you're doing it by taking the photographs and putting them up on your website. You're not permitted to do that. Of course, that's a commercial establishment. It's not a school. You can make some distinctions, but you could see at least the potential danger. And I must say that Toby Wolf, my colleague, was prescient enough to see what might come out differently if that was true. Of course, you can make the argument there's something different between regulations and policies of law schools that are aimed against discrimination as opposed to those that favor it, but you know, we sometimes don't always win on those grounds. The other part of it was, so aside from avoiding perhaps some bad fallout on some other areas, I think the most interesting thing about the decision in FAIR, and it's a little bit like some of the reactions that we had in some of the other cases, in terms of public reaction, but much more directly, taking up the cue from the Supreme Court that people could protest and people could let their views known. What happened once schools had to open their doors to the military recruiters and happened all across the country, but I saw it happen in a very forceful way at Penn Law School. Students did that. They protested, they had signs, they picketed. There were discussions that probably would not have been had if we had won that case. A lot of students were very angry about that. And in fact, they were much more energized by that process, the protest process, then arguments in court. As I said, we had a case in court and we had argued a summary judgment motion before FAIR was decided, and the students came and watched that, and they liked it, and that was interesting, right? You know, and a nice legal argument and so on and so forth, but nothing compared, right? Nothing compared to making signs and cutting class and protesting the JAG recruiters and you know, and also engaging them, right? Engaging them in debate, right? And students went in and pretended to be interviewing, right, for JAG position and let their positions known. Of course, as we now know, that was kind of part of this amazing movement in the last 8 years, which has turned the universe upside down in terms of gay and lesbian rights. It was just one part, a small part perhaps, but it caught the public imagination. As Eric said, we either do it or we shouldn't rely on the courts. And so ultimately, FAIR, which was, you know, in some ways a bad case in the First Amendment, perhaps it had some insight. That's not why Roberts wrote the decision the way he did, I can assure you. But it showed the power of kind of re-engineering our thoughts, reconsidering, and using some other methods to reach the same result.
Adam, let me just say one word. A few of the panelists have mentioned that they were very disappointed by the question and that they worked hard to get around it in some way. Well, I won't deny, I spent a lot of time deciding what the question should be, and I want it to be as fiendish as possible. And I wanted, in other words, for the panelists, A, to work on it a bit, not just do the usual civil liberties line, but I also wanted them to explain why the obvious was not true. And what they did was show that some things on the surface to all of us, which we thought was obvious, this case was wrong, but that it wasn't entirely wrong, that there was a way of looking at it that had a different spin. And I think the panelists did a remarkably good job. And I am so pleased that I allowed my worst instincts to go forward and put this question to you. So thank you very
So I was going to thank the panelists for all their comments, but maybe we should just thank Norman for a perfect question. So I'm excited to open up the conversation to everybody, but I guess before I do that, I want to ask one question, I guess, of anyone on the panel who's interested in commenting on it, because it seems to me that there really was a very common theme that threaded its way through almost everybody's remarks. And that, in a way, is this sort of very old theme about backlash and the politics of progressive legal change, right? So, you know, back in the Warren Court and in the wake of its decisions, backlash, you know, had this very different connotation. It was the worry that, you know, ambitious decisions like Brown would be undermined by Southern jurisdictions, or that Roe, while symbolically important, would be chipped away in a political movement in its aftermath. But all of you talked about really a very different kind of backlash, right? An idea that in recent years, oftentimes, it's been in Congress, or in the states, or in local governments, in the political process, where decisions that have otherwise not been so great have led, in a way, to the crystallization of political movements that have really promoted change. So, you know, Rachel started off with Ledbetter, which gave us the Lilly Ledbetter Act. Maddy talked about the way in which, you know, the terrible tragedy in Louisiana led to, it sounds like, really nationwide efforts that have, you know, that might make systematic changes in many, many more places than just a victory in that one lawsuit would have, right? And then in FAIR, I mean, not just the response to FAIR, but more broadly, right, with respect to the gay movement, gay rights movement over the last decade or so, on many instances, it seemed like terrible court decisions have then prompted political action. So I guess what I want to ask the panelists, well, I guess three things. So one is, if we think that this is a pattern that's recurring recently, then as civil rights or civil liberties lawyers, one question is, how do we think about this dynamic in individual cases when we're litigating them? I suppose the second question, broader, would be, how, as leaders of organizations, should we think about the way that those organizations should pursue social change? And I guess to pick up on Eric's idea, should we all be litigating like democracy issues instead? So should we be fighting about districted elections or the structure of the Senate more if now it looks like actually political venues might be the most plausible place where we're going to accomplish a progressive change kind of in the near term, right? So this might go back to Gemma's idea that, well maybe the response to Shelby and litigation like that might matter not just for voting rights, but actually for all these issues. So does anyone, so I want to open that up to anyone who has thoughts.
My view is that this system is in an existential crisis as to whether or not a democratic republic can really survive, given the structural impediments that have been built into the system and which have now come to the fore in a way. It's not the first time, obviously. It's happened two or three or four times in our history. And in those two or three or four times in our history, there were tumultuous political events that broke the stalemate, the Civil War, the Depression, the Civil Rights Movement. But we can't wait around for Lincoln, Roosevelt, and Johnson on the one hand, but I don't think these issues are really issues that we as civil liberties lawyers or any lawyers are going to be able to affect in any fundamental way through litigation. I think it's a political crisis, and I think as lawyers, if we can figure out ways that we can marginally help in that political struggle, that would be great. But I think it's a political crisis that is going to be fought out very viciously over the next 20 years, and I don't know how it's going to come out.
Yeah, I think one of the things that has noted, you know, we've got this state of affairs currently with Congress, and there isn't really much hope on being able to rely on them, right? And you, one of the things that you asked was what organizations might be able to do. And I think when you look at issues relating to gay rights, women's rights, you know, much of that was affected by some ground roots kind of movement, right? To really that showed the extent of the pervasive discrimination and how we as a nation, with the history that we have, really could not continue to live with that. And so, you know, if you think about the, again, I will again say I am not a voting rights expert, okay? But when you look at what is now going to be needed in the context of voting rights after Shelby in relation to litigation, it's going to be these individual cases, right, that are going to take years. The harm is going to have happened already before people can challenge them. You know, you have the Justice Department saying, well, maybe we'll use another part of Section 2, of the Voting Rights Act to bring cases. But again, it's going to be against one state, one municipality, one locality. And what we saw in the recent elections quite honestly, I think was very different than what we had seen 4 years before. You know, the number of people and those who, the young, the people of color who had come out, who came out in the most recent presidential election, it was really more a response to these kind of, you know, voting laws that would have an effect of marginalizing people and not allowing them to vote, right? And had less to do with what might have 4 years before been really a lot of, wow, Barack Obama, right? So I don't think it can be done alone by us as lawyers and by civil libertarians. I think we're really gonna need to bring people in, educate them about the reality of how these laws affect their lives. And so I think it's going to be bringing everybody in and showing how these laws sort of slap in the face of fairness and dignity.
Just for a second, I mean, we should open it up soon to everybody else, but we've never been able to rely just on the laws and just on lawyers to affect changes that we need. I mean, I just think the tools are different. Every single one of us went into this business because we thought we could help in this way, but if we really wanted to affect change, we were doing it in the context of a social movement or a political force or whatever legislative effort. It's always been multifaceted. Change has not come from any one place. So all we do now is react to outrageous decisions as outrageous decisions and move on to some other place. And I think, you know, the real change for the moment won't come for the court. Maybe in 20 or 30 years when we sit back in this room, we'll be talking about the heyday of the amazing Supreme Court that we are living in and all the great things that they've done. And we can't wait. And some of us will just, you know, hope for that day. But I think we just use the tools we have, and that's why we chose this area of law or the organizations we run. We'll do with it what they give us, and we'll make it into a good thing, which is what we sort of talked about today.
Just to add one more quick thing, I think at the ACLU, we're really, I don't want to say struggling, but I think in the course of the last decade have done a lot of rethinking about what it means to be litigators in this era, right? It's a lot of preventing backsliding, but most importantly, I think there's been a lot of rethinking about how the communications and public education infrastructure fits in with the litigation work. So it's something that's not instinctive to litigators, and I'm a young litigator, I'm relatively new to the profession, but I know that, you know, my training in law school and how I've come into the profession didn't really set me up to think about the media strategy and the web strategy and the public education motivating our activists around the issues we're working on with our litigation. But I think that is actually a very important part of strategizing about what litigation to bring and you know, sometimes even what legal arguments to bring or how to speak about those arguments. And it's really difficult for us as lawyers to, I think, to kind of get this extra judicial big picture to be part of our thinking. But I think it's incredibly important.
Okay, questions for all of you. And let me just say that the acoustics in this room are a bit, shall we say, awkward. So if you do have a question, please use your mic. Otherwise, people will not be able to hear you.
Wayne Alton, class of 74. I agree with Eric that we've got a political crisis, and I think part of the reason for that is the influence of money on our political system. And one of the civil liberties positions that I've always struggled with is the anti-campaign finance position of the Civil Liberties Union. And I think the Supreme Court was right in whatever the decisions were upholding the McCann-Feingold laws, and I think the Citizens United decision was terrible for our political system. And I think that this is an area where the pure civil liberties position, I think, is a real problem for our political system and our democracy.
I couldn't agree more. And in fact, I had the honor number of years ago of representing Norman and a number of ex ACLU officials in McCain-Feingold and filing an amicus brief, and we were happy when we won that, but it's been, as you said, it's been completely wiped out at this point. I think it really is one of the two or three keys to the problems we face today, and it's growing because the influence of this kind of money is overwhelming. I think that there are, and we did make, and the court in McCain-Feingold adopted civil liberties consistent responses to the position of McConnell and of the ACLU itself in that case, I don't see any way with the current court of reversing the trend that just gets worse and worse by the day.
Let's have some more comments from the audience.
John Strong, also from the class of 74. First of all, Norman, I think it really was a fiendish question. I've been wrestling with it ever since I got the email about the reunion. I thought that Eric's choice of Heller interesting in that, from my perspective, Heller was a pro-civil liberties decision, not an anti-civil liberties decision. The right to defend oneself, to me, is a basic right, that decision found that right existed in the Constitution and was still allowed government, which is the traditional adversary of civil libertarians, to restrict the gun rights reasonably. And I'm glad that Wayne brought up the Citizens United, because it's obviously a case, an issue that on which civil libertarians take different positions. My wrestling with the decision, the question, got me to the Bong Hits for Jesus case, which doctrinally was awful, but as a practical matter, I don't think will have much effect on kids. I think kids are either going to go out and rebel and do what the hell they want, regardless of the consequences, or they're too timid to do something in the first place. So I don't think that decision as a practical matter will have much effect, but I do think that it was a terrible decision.
Jenny Pizer, class of 87, Gemma's cohort. And so I have a comment picking up on what David was saying about the Elaine photography case that the Supreme Court might take up this coming session, and the idea of litigation in the context of a social movement. I guess first I wanted to say I'm not sure whether I'm a little bit bemused or what I think the couple of different comments about, I think David, you said that something about the LGBT movement of the past 8 years or so, and I sort of think, well, there's been an awful lot of focus on marriage, and I have done a lot of that at Lambda Legal, and many of us think about that as having been in the spotlight for 20 years since the Hawaii case, about which Sylvia knows a lot. But the first marriage case was 20 years before that, and so I do think of it as a much longer span, but the fact that it's been in the spotlight so much more recently and folks think of it now this way is kind of great, because it means a lot more people are noticing, and we need a lot more allies because there aren't as many of us. And so however we count the years, it's great that we have a lot more help now. But
I guess the thing I've been focusing on a lot, and the Elaine photography case illustrates this, the tension between a couple of different civil liberties principles, the religious freedom rights claimed by some who don't want to provide goods or services to gay people or same-sex couples, and maybe other people too, but in particular, a lot of these cases are about goods or services related to weddings or not, where somebody operating a for-profit business doesn't want to provide those services, notwithstanding a public accommodations law. So that religious liberty right, and then the equality right, the equal access right of the individuals or couples who are seeking services in the marketplace. What I think, where we are right now, and what I think is interesting is, and what I encounter a lot in doing some of this work, is an initial reaction of people. And this gets expressed in, you know, editorials with sort of a regular basis, is, okay, well, maybe the couple was right that the law, you know, applies and they should get the services, but gosh, couldn't you pick your fights better? You know, why are you fighting about these things? It's not such a big deal, and you could get your services somewhere else. And when the cases are litigated, not all of them, but a number of them, we're having, as in the Elaine photography case, some good success getting the principle enforced that the marketplace is supposed to be for everyone, at least when there's a public accommodations law saying so, that it ought to be followed, and that the consequences of having the kind of religious exemption that's being claimed would really be disastrous if that were to be accepted, or at least if it were accepted broadly as opposed to sort of a gay-specific exception, which is sometimes what's being sought and sometimes being sought in the legislative process. What it says to me that I think may be responsive to this particular bigger picture question is the role that I think impact litigation, at least this storytelling kind of impact litigation, as opposed to sort of dealing with a big institution, when it involves a story, as in, say, the prisons conditions cases, or as you were talking about evidence being withheld, when there's a compelling story, I think that still has huge potential to reach people in this age of internet information and blogging and Fox News and whatever. I do think it's still very powerful, and it also needs to be part of a movement. And when it is part of a movement, then that rallies more people to participate. You know, this issue of religion being used to discriminate either against gay people or to excise certain parts of important healthcare coverage or some of the other ways we're seeing it used, I think is very, very troubling. And in particular, it's troubling the way people respond so often initially, it's sort of having lost track of the idea that the marketplace is for everyone, and a willingness to accept the idea that some people should go down the street to somewhere else and get the services somewhere else because the proprietor doesn't want to sell to them. The readiness that lots of people seem to have, including editorial boards who presumably think about it for a minute before they write, to say that is really worrying to me. And so that, I think, is part of the work of the expanding LGBT and allies movement, but I think that's a principle for all of the issues that we're concerned about, that we continue to use impact litigation, but with the public education part of that work being as important as ever and maybe more so.
Right, I think the same issues came up in the 60s after Title IV was enacted, when proprietors at businesses throughout the country said, well, I have a religious objection to serving blacks. I mean, when Lester Maddox stood there with his axe, he also held up a cross. And that was pretty much rejected back then. And I can't imagine that we're going to go back, but who knows?
So I came in late, so I don't know if I'm off base on something that was already said, but your mention of stories and the discussion of from a new litigator.
Why don't you identify yourself just...
Oh, I'm sorry. Rachel Pine. I was the class of 1983.
Rachel
Oh, okay. There's something I missed. Anyway, so I wanted to sort of explore the strategic role of data-driven, evidentiary, evidence-based policy analytics in our purest civil liberties objectives. There are weaknesses to building cases from facts that can change, but more than just working the political system to wait for another day, it may not be that people just change their views. Maybe we have to change the views with more than spin and media and PR of the day, but in some deeper cultural engagement. And so I'm not exactly sure what that means, but that's in tension with a pure principle approach. And so I'm interested in comments on that.
One comment, which struck me, you talk about kind of data-driven and how we can use that. I think a very good example of that recently is the stop and frisk decision in New York, Judge Shiland's decision. We've been litigating the same issue in Philadelphia, but what strikes me when you look at the universe of data, which fortunately the New York City Police Department had to collect because of a former lawsuit by the center, the experts, even though they disagreed on benchmarks and analysis, were able to show that in fact this whole claim, right, that stop and frisk was making us safer, had a lot of flaws. I mean, I'm not saying it doesn't have some effect, but ultimately, when you looked at 4.4 million stops and a hit rate of less than 2% for weapons, you knew what was going on was kind of random policing and often targeted at minorities. And so the use of that data, I mean, you couldn't have won that case without that data. You couldn't have won it just on the stories. The data was really overwhelming, as it turns out to be very similar in every city that keeps the data. And the real fight now is to make sure departments keep it. They don't want to keep it because they know what it'll expose. So that issue of, and it also ties in, I think, that the political fight was won here. I mean, it wasn't just a legal fight. I think New York's minds were changed ultimately. And the great statistic, of course, in the last year is that the stops are down in the last 18 months by over 50%, from 700,000 to about 300,000, and the murder rate keeps going down miraculously. I mean, there's some good policing going on, but it's probably not attributable to, you know, stop and frisk. But without that data, you couldn't have begun to, litigate that case.
You know, what I think is so interesting about Floyd is that, well, it is a perfect example of a case where the data played a huge role, but it's also a perfect example of a case where the social movement played a huge role. And that was a movement that had been building over two decades, really, or before, and an earlier case that was the precursor to Floyd, which had resulted in a successful settlement, really hadn't made the kind of impactful change that I think CCR and its allies had hoped for when we thought we came to a good, reasonable, anti-racial profile settlement out of that first litigation. So I think what I hope is going to be so different this time around is that the just amazing groundswell of attention to the issue that has come through sort of sustained community involvement with the litigation and with the movement is going to be continued into the remedial process in the case. So to say it is not just winning, you know, a decision on liability here that gets us to a real victory, it's what do you do with that decision afterwards? And that's why the plaintiffs in the case have fought so strongly and are succeeding in enforcing a remedial process that involves all of the community stakeholders and that actually brings the communities to the table to talk about how can we rechange, how can we reshape the NYPD. So while I think this is, you know, it's a hugely important lesson to learn about how to litigate in a successful way, I worry sometimes that we may think that the only time it is appropriate to focus our litigation efforts is where those social movements exist and where those social movements seem as though they could bring about real lasting change. And I don't think that's the only place for impact litigation. I think there also has to be a real place for, you know, the lone voice in the wilderness saying no to injustice and standing up because you see something that is terribly wrong that is happening, even when there is not a social movement that exists around the issue and there's unlikely to be a social movement for many, many years. And a lot of times those cases lose. We bring them knowing they're going to lose, but we hope that the, you know, some attention that a piece of litigation demands will begin to educate people to an issue, will begin to move things slowly, even if it's only, you know, 20, 30, 40 years later, that the public and the courts look back and say, oh, okay, this was a spark that was a real beginning. And that, you know, even a lesson from this panel is that we can't be afraid to bring those cases that we know we may lose, that we're likely to lose, because maybe losing is what does create a spark, sets the stage for winning in the future.
As you were talking, I thought, that's right, we can only bring those cases when the data points us that way. So I wasn't going to the social movement need, but to the data need, because sometimes we won't have it. I agree that Shinlin would not have decided it, could not have decided it the way she did without the data, and it was extremely important. But I also think the center and others in the case and around the case did use individual stories and got those individual people out among those 700,000, 4.4 million people who, you know, they got the stories out of individual people. And while in the changing in hearts and minds of folks, the data was compelling for those who know the data, and the decision was important for those who listened to the decision, those individual stories impacted lots of, you know, made lots of people think differently about, oh my God, that's what goes on. It's a real person who's being stopped. Nothing, they've done nothing wrong. There they are, and it's not okay. And so I think that, in fact, it's a good example of all three of those things being used. But I certainly agree with you both that you don't have to have all of the elements to move forward. Otherwise, we'd almost do nothing.
I have a question for the panel. I was surprised when Mr. Lieberman raised a gun control case as a civil liberties case. And I mean, I do not make my annual donation to the ACLU so that they can support my neighbor's right to pack heat. My question for the panel is, do you all consider Second Amendment gun control cases to be within the ambit of civil liberties law? Oh, I'm Albert Podell, class of 76, and I was a troublemaker back then too.
Okay, I'll brave this one a little bit. I'm speaking as an individual, not as a representative of my organization. Because the Center for Constitutional Rights will not be taking on a Second Amendment case anytime soon. That said, you know, I think the historical context is really important here. And that speaks to me. I think you said it beautifully in introducing the concept and the idea, and you know, there's a reality to that history, given the way this world seems to be moving. I think it's not unlikely that we will come to a time in our future where life is far more lawless than it is today, as you know, economy and climate collapses. And I don't know that the right to bear arms will not become a civil liberties issue, especially as our government moves more towards martial law.
I'm Liz Schneider, class of 73, and although I can barely believe that I'm actually doing this, in my current life, which is as a law professor, in addition to teaching women in the law and domestic violence, et cetera, I also teach civil procedure. And so one of the issues, of course, is the changing role of the federal courts and the degree to which access to courts is now severely limited as a result of the Supreme Court's procedural changes on summary judgment and on pleading. You may all be aware or not be aware that the Advisory Committee on the Civil Rules is now proposing changes to the federal rules that would severely cut back on discovery. So we are in a very different time. When I was sort of in the same general time that David Rudovsky was talking about, and of course, access to federal courts at that time was obviously such a huge issue. And now, of course, what we're seeing are that there's lots of forum shopping going around the country, and often it's basically staying in state courts in order to not go through the very serious procedural burdens that are now placed on litigants. And that issue of access to justice in the federal courts is a very big issue. I don't agree for a minute, honestly, that Shira Scheinlund, that another federal district judge, could absolutely not have concluded what Shira Scheinlund did. I believe so strongly and now see and teach to judges and whatever, cognitive bias is such a profound issue. And yes, evidence-based presentations and data, et cetera, are critically important, as they've always been. This is not a new development. They've always been incredibly important. But what we see now, for example, on questions of getting past 12b6 rulings, is that what the Supreme Court has said and what many district judges now feel they have to do is to be the gatekeepers at the pleading stage at 12b6 to not allow those cases to go forward. So I want to just speak to, in addition to the substantive issues, about access to justice and how, and access to the federal courts, and how incredibly important that is also in part of our thinking, and how we've got to be thinking constantly back and forth between substance and procedure and substance and procedure.
I just want to address the question from I don't remember your name, I'm sorry. On whether this is a civil liberties issue. I think that it's a civil liberties issue both ways. Clearly, the proponents of the Second Amendment consider it a civil liberties issue, and clearly, the proponents of the right to bear arms, as I indicated, are historically have come from a wide variety of political perspectives. But there's also a civil liberties issue in terms, it's not traditional in terms of a limitation on government, but it's a civil liberties issue in terms of the power of government to protect the life, liberty, and property of the people of this country by enacting reasonable kinds of legislation that would do so. And I consider that a very strong civil liberties issue. I always do, always have. And I think the problem that we face is that, at least on the national level, well, we can't get anywhere with that.
May I just add a footnote? About 40 years ago, maybe 45, the ACLU Board of Directors voted that it was a civil liberty to regulate gun control, just the way Eric put it. After a few years, several people on the board said, look, there is a constitutional amendment here, the Second Amendment. There is an individual right of some kind. So the board did a very heroic thing. It just repealed the earlier policy without taking a position one way or the other. So this conversation is actually something that could have taken place a couple of generations ago.
Tom Viles of 87. I was intrigued by Eric's remarks. I would not have thought of Heller as being such a case as posited in this three-line question. Again, I think civil libertarians are in a position right now where they have to take their victories where they can find them. Some of my work is representing young people who have been committed of serious felonies, and the charges generally take gun laws and gun regulations and pile on, so that you have a situation where a young 21-year-old man makes one mistake in a liquor store, and he's facing 60 years of jail time because you've got felon in possession, possession during a crime of violence, unauthorized possession of a handgun, unauthorized ammo. I mean, it goes on and on. What I have been able to do in some of these cases, using Heller and I guess riding this white knight of the Second Amendment, is to argue that with the way the Supreme Court has sawn the corners off these laws and qualify them well, it has to be within the curtilage of your house, it has to be for self-defense, you can't be a felon or mentally defective, but you know, with those qualifications, the law is okay. And to argue that, well, now you have a half a dozen gun control laws that look exactly alike, it isn't this double, triple, quintuple jeopardy. And I mean, that's worked sometimes. I can't say it's always worked. But I mean, and this is just a more general view, is that in my lifetime, in my professional lifetime, I've seen the country lose most of its safety net, become intensely punitive. And its solution to every problem is another punishment, more jail time, less equitable discretion on the part of the courts, and so forth. I am sorry with all my heart that I missed Rachel Meeropol's speech when she talked, but I would be disappointed if she did not, you know, highlight the huge encroachment of the national security state at the same time that the safety net is being eroded. And we are really going into something that looks a lot like, forgive me for saying this, class struggle. And it's only going to get worse. I don't think, when I was in law school, I thought that, well, you know, the court's the sort of the royal road to social reform. I don't think it is anymore. I mean, I do think it's going to be legislation and it's going to be outside of the judicial arena. I mean, you know, we have a country right now where about a third of the people are one hospital bill away from living in their cars. So with that said, I mean, I think that my views of the law have changed a great deal. I've become much more modest in my expectations. But I think that a little creative lawyering, you can find sort of interstitial victories to win along the way. Just don't count on the courts to take care of the problem anymore.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Diller, class of 1997. So just to add to that, one thing I was struck by when Eric and Gemma spoke is that we kind of immediately went to the idea of legislative dysfunction that will prohibit us from fixing what the court did. And we kind of skipped over the fact that in both of the cases you talked about, these were legislative victories. Particularly the Voting Rights Act, of course, where the court has now interfered with the democratic process. And I think that's a common theme of some of the worst decisions we've seen out of this court. It's the Citizens United case. It's the striking down the Medicaid expansion. And so the challenge we face is not just that the court might not expand our notion of civil liberties and civil rights under the Constitution, but that all the hard-fought victories we've won, even legislatively, are being chipped away at. And I don't know that we've fully come to grips with that new reality. So I don't know if anyone has a thought or comment on that.
I don't have a thought that's going to do anything to answer that, quite honestly. But I think that Shelby was really stark in that, right? When you had a record that you did, and for the court to just sweepingly kind of say, well, no, sorry, we're dealing with the historical context that doesn't exist anymore. Is for many in the civil rights, you know, sort of voting rights context, it was a devastating blow, right? To for that very reason, right? A court can just, and not even, you know, we didn't have a majority. I mean, we didn't have a plurality. It wasn't like, oh, this is unanimous, right? There was this split decision where five just Supreme Court justices could just sort of take it all away. And now there's so much more of a fight that has to happen that it just makes us say, all right, the struggle continues. Let's hold on and keep it going.
I would say I agree with your point very much. However, I think it's very it's very disheartening that 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 25 years ago, probably even 6 or 7 years ago, if the court had done what it did in Shelby, Congress would have immediately enacted a new statute. And today, that's an impossibility.
Hi, my name is Brian Chelkin. I'm a fellow who graduated last year in 2013. And I agree that Norman's question was tricky, but I don't think any of the panelists actually admitted that the court was right and that civil libertarians were wrong on any of the cases that they mentioned. All the cases were horribly decided, but maybe we can live with them somehow. And maybe it's because I'm fresh enough out of law school that I still overly criticize and think my convictions and question my convictions that I think this. But one case for me just this past year was Maryland versus King, the DNA arrestee case. I strongly believe that the court was wrong in deciding it, but I'm increasingly questioning whether I'm wrong in that analysis, because it just seems like there hasn't been much of a backlash, at least among the people that I talk to, and I talk to a lot of civil libertarian-minded people. Maybe I'm not talking to the right ones, but and the polling that I've seen is awful. And I mean, it's, I guess, limited to people who have been arrested, so it's easy enough for a lot of people to push that as something that doesn't affect them because it only affects the arrestees. But it seems ironic to me that this, what should be a classic example of like a civil libertarian's nightmare, which is a government database of all of our DNA profiles, actually seems to me like not at all that far off in the future, and something that the American public seems more willing to swallow than a lot of the other issues that we've raised. So I was wondering if any of the panelists had comments on that, especially Maddy from the Innocence Project, and then if you can think of any other cases where, if we're not wrong, and I'm not suggesting we're wrong, and I look forward to talking to everyone and being reaffirmed that we're right on this one, but are there areas where we're fighting losing battles that people are concerned about and sort of being wrong in the long term because it's just not going our way?
I guess I didn't choose it because I don't think it's a decision that either where they were right or that we can live with. Because I think it was terribly wrong and that we can't live with it. And you're right, there's not a huge backlash to the decision that says it's just fine to retain people's DNA sample upon arrest for lots of reasons, and partly that people, I think, don't understand it and that we probably haven't done a good job of explaining why it's such a violation. I mean, I'm certainly a person who thought 20 years ago that DNA testing on for convicted people was completely questionable and a violation of the Fourth Amendment, and I couldn't believe that the decisions went down one after the next to say that was fine. On arrestees, if you'd asked me 10 years ago, I would have said, of course not. I mean, if nothing else, innocent until proven guilty. Innocent until proven guilty, they'll never uphold it. And they, of course, did, and I think we just haven't explained it. That, you know, DNA is not like a fingerprint. DNA, innocent, the presumption of innocence must mean something. We have lost that, and we're going to have to fight it out in a different way. I do think, though, criminal law is a place, not criminal law per se, but just criminal justice in this country is a place that we are making some progress. At some level, people did, maybe not in this DNA area, but in others, we realized enough is enough, it's too much. And we are seeing, not at the federal level so much, although maybe, you know, crack cocaine disparity being ridiculous down to simply absurd at 18 to 1 from 100 to 1 is progress. In the states, we're seeing people that are tired of it, and we're seeing challenges and successful challenges to three strikes in California, to mandatory minimums. We're beginning to make a difference there. So I think there's hope in some legislatures. It may be right now that in Congress, we shouldn't hold our breath.
I think the time is about up.
Yeah, so we are out of time. So just one administrative announcement, which is we're going to proceed from here over to D'Agostino, where we'll have cocktails, I think. Norman always likes a cocktail before dinner, so I think that's what we'll be having.
Nobody is required to have a cocktail.
But please join me in thanking our spectacular panelists.